read two scriptures to you this morning to begin our service, to give you some kind of idea of the difference in heaven and the difference here in the minds of the people. In Revelation chapter 6, I want us to begin reading in verse 9. And the title of the message today is, How Long, O Lord? How long? How long will it be before all of this has come to a pass and that everything will be made new again? But in Revelation chapter 6, beginning in verse 9, I must draw you a picture here. And keep this in mind. This is heaven's view as they look back to the earth. This is a picture of those that were martyred during the tribulation period after we have been raptured out. And then these are saved under the preaching of the 144,000 Israelites or Jews that God seals, and they become his evangelistic group of people, and they preach the gospel of Jesus. And this group of people here have accepted Christ, but they have been killed for it. And so we find them crying out then in their transformation from earth to heaven, and they are looking back to this earth. It said that when he had opened the fifth seal, I saw under the altar the souls of them that were slain for the word of God and for the testimony which they held. And they cried with a loud voice, saying, How long, O Lord? That's where you get the title of our message today. As they're crying out, How long, O Lord, holy and true, dost thou not judge and avenge our blood on them that dwell on the earth? And white robes were given unto every one of them, and it was said unto them that they should rest yet for a little season, until their fellow servants also and their brethren that should be killed as they were should be fulfilled. In this scripture here, we get a picture of this group that has been faithful to the Lord, and they have followed him, but it's brought them to their death. Now, their view here is revenge. It's an amazing thing when you get out of the midst of sin and get in the presence of nothing but holiness, how your attitude changes about sin. You see, they realize now, as they are there in heaven, they realize now what sin, the cost of sin. They realize what it's like to be in the presence of a holy and just Christ that had never committed no sin. So as they look back to this earth, they're crying out for revenge. They're saying, God, when are you going to judge those people? When are you going to revenge our death? They killed us because we followed you. Now, that's their attitude as they look back upon the scene and as they talk to the Lord there in heaven. Now, mind you, in a few moments, we'll come back to earth again. And we will see what the attitude here in earth's view of our Lord. But let's talk about a little bit about what preceded their cry. What preceded the cry of this group that was slain for the Lord, that were martyred for Christ? What preceded them is the very same things that precedes us. The only difference is that it was in a much greater way in their time than it is in our time. So when we look here and we find that what preceded their cry was this, before their death was deception. The work of Satan is what preceded them, just like it is for us. Always remember that word deception, because I believe it is the most powerful word that Satan and powerful work that Satan does to people. He's good at deception. If you remember back in heaven when Lucifer fell, how that he deceived one third of all the angels to follow him. My goodness. He must be a person of influence. He must know how to use that word deception. And then when we come to Genesis chapter 3, verses 4 and 5, listen to what the scripture says, and we see the power of deception once again. Look with me in verses 4 and 5. And the serpent said unto the woman, ye shall not surely die. See, he's putting deception in her heart, I think. And he said, for God doth know that in the day you eat thereof, then your eyes shall be opened, and ye shall be as the gods, knowing good from evil. Satan uses deception upon the first family of this earth. Deception was the most powerful tool that he could use to bring down the fall of Adam and Eve. And so it is a term and a work that he uses today to influence the mind of the people. And those people that were martyred, they knew what it was like to fight deception. It would have been easy for those people to have accepted the Antichrist. It would have been easy for those people to have took the mark of the beast. That was the easy way out. And he tried to deceive them into doing that, but they did not listen. Just like he's trying to deceive us today, and we must not listen. Deception is what preceded their death. So we find that the first horse in the first seal was the man of deception, riding across the land, disguised as one who wants to bring peace. But he's anything but that. But that is the deception that he brings to the people. I think one of the things that saddens our heart today is how easy people can be deceived. It's because that people is easy to be deceived is the very reason that Satan has chose that true deception to enlarge his camp and to defeat you and I. So they had to face deception. What would we do if you were here? Suppose that the rapture of the church took place right now, at this moment, and you were left behind. You would be facing a more difficult challenge through deception then than you would be now. Because you see, now it's pretty easy. Life is not too difficult here now. But once the rapture of the church takes place, and those that are left behind, the Bible says you're going to face the most difficult time that there's ever been on the face of this earth. I'm sure that those that during the flood was beating on the side of the boat wanting to get in thought it was the worst time of their life. I'm sure that the children of Israel, as they marched down to Babylon, captivity under Nebuchadnezzar, they thought, this is the worst time of our life. But I'll tell you, when the church is lifted out and God gives the Antichrist the reins to do what he wants to do under his control, it's going to be the worst time it's ever been. So these people that accepted Christ as their Savior, no wonder they cried out for revenge, because they accepted Christ under the worst conditions that anyone could ever accept him. But you know what? Today, you and I could accept Christ. If you're here and you don't know Christ, you could receive him today and go home and be happy. And rejoice in your new relationship with Christ. This group of people had accepted Christ, and all they knew to do was run and hide and try to find a place that Satan and his crew couldn't get to them. And they still got to them, and they killed him. Deception. That's the work of Satan. But in the second horse that these had to face was the war, the conflict, the desire of Satan, and the work of Satan to conquer everyone. No wonder Jesus said, he asked a question, he said, who is my brethren? He said, is it my father? Or is it my mother? Is it my brother? He said, no, it's those that follow me. When the Antichrist seeks to conquer the people, it's a sad thing when you see a father maybe accept Jesus and have to die and the mother not. Or the mother or the wife accept Christ and the husband not. Or the parents accept Christ and the children doesn't. And the parents die. Or even if the children accept Christ and the parents don't, and the children die. It's war. It's a different kind of war that we think of with missiles and tanks. It's a war within the family. It is a war within the people all over the world. It's a war that Satan tries to conquer. I'm going to war with Christ. I'm going to war with you. And Satan says, you die. But we find that the third horse, well, it tells us in Galatians chapter 5, verse 17, it tells us how that war that is in the midst, that war that we battle every day, that you and I battle, the war of the flesh and the spirit. It's a battle between us. The flesh wants to be conquered by Satan. The spirit wants Jesus. It's a battle. They had to face all of that. Plus they had to face the army. But in the third one, it says there would be a famine. So then there's deception, there's war that they had to face, and then they had to face famine. So, stop and think about it. You know, I wonder how many of you might even know that. And so your soul. Had to sell their soul or to give their soul to Christ. He You see, the Antichrist will use them to control how you and I feel. You see, the one thing that you can do is you. You know what? You will go home today. Except maybe someone. You'll go home today and you'll find plenty of food in the country. You'll find food to give to your children. Or if you don't have them stay at home, you'll take them out to a restaurant somewhere and you will find them. But what if you're a man and a woman and you've got three kids? And they tell you, unless you take the mark of the beast, unless you accept the Antichrist and follow him, you can't have no food. You can't have no medical services for your three kids. You can't have anything for your three kids. What are you going to do? They had to face these things in a much greater difficulty. And this group made a choice and said, I will take Christ. See, it's personal. This group was personal for them to bring judgment and revenge from those people. Those people that died under those circumstances, they hated the circumstances that they came out of, and they wanted judgment brought. How long is it going to be before you? You see, food and clothing, the things that go on today, can really affect how you feel and your actions. You see, when I was a little kid, it wasn't that Ma didn't know that making hungry was something. She knew that it was wrong. But it was because we have no money, because we did not have no way of eating or paying the fire bill. See, when you have Christ, then you have to trust him. I wish Maud had Christ, but she didn't have Christ. She didn't trust Christ. Maud didn't trust Christ. They never taught me to trust Christ.
See,
family can really affect us. And it can bring you. On the earth at that time that took the mark of the beast and they became a follower of the Antichrist, they were in total submission to him just so that they could get. And you say, well, what do we do? We do the same thing. What did he do to the people of Israel? He provided. Now, Stephen Van Cock, the great preacher from Old England, was walking home one night
and he did not have a dime in his pocket. And there was no food at home. He had nothing. And he said, what am I going to tell my wife and my children when I get home that I have no money and we have no food?
Fourth course then was death. Look at 2 Corinthians chapter 1. Death. This is that group. You see, the Bible said death, but they're living. They're talking. They're not dead. Just their body was dead. We worry too much about the body. The body is still alive. But look at what he said. I believe it's in 2 Corinthians 1:9. But we have the sentence of death in ourselves, that we should not trust in ourselves, but in God which raiseth the dead. We should not trust in ourselves, but trust in the God that raises us. That means that they were killed. They were killed for what reason? Well, in Matthew chapter 16, and you'll find out what. Matthew chapter 16, verses 44. If any man shall come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross and follow me. For whosoever will save his life shall lose it, and whosoever will lose his life shall save it. Can I tell you why? Revelation tells us why also. They were martyred because they followed Christ. And they took up their cross and they followed Christ. What does it mean to follow Christ? They carried the testimony of God. So they died for their testimony of God.
they died because they would not comply with the world, and they said, my God is real, my God is alive, my God lives in me, I will not deny him, I will take up him, and I will follow him.
You're God.
They died. Why were they mourned? Because of their testimony. Elohim and Adonai, one God, that is my God. We all took today, and we escaped, and we were here. And God said, how would we react? I'm trying to get us to live in a real world. I'm trying to get us to serve a real God, and to help us to realize that this is a real situation that we're in. And your testimony says everything about you. Your testimony for the Word of God, and your testimony for the one and true and true. How long? He said, well, you got to make that. And then he told them, he said, just wait. Their work's not done. Their work's not done. I guess in to those that were martyrs, he could have said to them, work is not done. My husband. He said the cost of serving Christ is not going to be. The cost of serving Christ. And as we look at the earth, let's take our view of this moment before now. Our view is, and I want you to ask this question, look at me in Revelation. Beginning in verse 17, and the Lord and the bride said, come. The Spirit. Let him that heareth say, come. And let him that is athirst come. And whosoever believeth, let him take of the water of life. For I testify unto every man that heareth the word of the prophecy of this book. If any man shall add unto these things, God shall add unto him the plague that only is. And if any man shall take away from the words of the book of this prophecy, God shall take away his and out of the whole city, and out of the country, which are written. First, he which testifies these things, saith, surely I am guilty. Now notice, let's distinguish them. The red letter here illustrates that this is what we do. Surely I am guilty. And then, even so, come forth. That is the cry of the church. That is the cry of the living. Even so, come. But I want to tell you something. There were some difficult things that preceded those that were crying out over the altar. But for us here, there will be some things that will preceded us in the direction of the church. Here already, can't see it today, then they see it today. If you can't see it today, then I doubt if you can. If you can't see it. So then as we look at the body, and the body said, we can say, but what is going to proceed is prayer. What is the spiritual condition of the dead? Well, we find this in Revelation. And we find this here beginning in verse 3. This is what they call the life. And it says, and unto the angel of the church of Christ, write these things. The beginning of the creation. I know thy works, that thou art neither cold nor hot. I would that thou wert cold or hot. So then, because thou art lukewarm and neither cold nor hot, I will spew thee out of thy mouth. Because thou sayest, I am rich. And have need of me, and knoweth that I was sick, and miserable, and poor, and blind. I counsel thee to buy of me gold, tried and fine, that thou mayest be rich in thy name, that thou mayest be clothed, and that the shame of thy name be not seen, and anoint thy eyes. As many as I love, I will give to the fellowship. The servant where you are today. Yes, sir. How far will the Lord let this take place? But it's certainly on a cliff. born Christian this morning. He said to return you here. He says that there was a sin that was missing the one sin. But it had to travel a great distance to the population. And when it got to in other words, you didn't want to know. You didn't try to find out. because that's how I know it's going to be all right. I'm not listening to myself, I'm listening to Him. And I want you to know, I'm not satisfied with who I am. There takes a lot of room for improvement in my life. And my desire is every morning when I pray, God, help me to be better today. Help me to live closer today. Because in the lot of being church, there was a limit of what we did. And you know what? The wayward believers in that church control the testimony. The wayward believers in most congregations control the message.